Brady, I want to tell you about what sounds like a totally impossible problem to solve. And in fact, by the end of this little talk, it will still be impossible. On the other hand, it'll also seem quite easy, paradoxically. And the title of this little story is Powers of Two, and you're asked to solve the following problem. You've got to pick four numbers, integers, but they can be positive or negative, any integers you want. And you want them to have the property that if you look at the sums of pairs of them, they're powers of two. And you want as many powers of two as you can. So if you could pick four numbers whose sums are powers of two, you could pick 1111 because the sum of any two of them is two. And so there are six ways to pick two of them, and we get six powers of two out of this. But there's one other rule I haven't told you. The numbers have to be distinct. So you can't do 1111. So let's do a simple case. Let's start off with two numbers. So if n is one, you can't do anything. There are no sums of pairs if you've just got a single number. If you've got two numbers, I'll call the value a of n as usual. If you've got two numbers, you could take them to be 1 and 3. 1 and 3, because the sum of them is 4, which is a power of 2. And there's only one sum you can get with two numbers. And so we've solved it. With two numbers, you take 1 and 3. You could have taken 3 and 5. It's not unique, but it would give you a single power of 2. Good. Okay. What about three numbers? Would you care to give me three numbers, Brady, that I would add whose sums in pairs are powers of two, three distinct numbers?
Okay, so a pair of two, so
Yeah.
1, 2, and 5.
Yeah, not bad. Let's make it 1, 3, and 5, because that does a little better. 1, 3, and 5. How many do we get? Well, 1 plus 3 is 4. Good. 3 plus 5 is 8. Good. 1 plus 5 is 6. Doesn't count. It's got to be a power of two. That would give two powers of two. Can we do better? Well, yes. Take minus 1, 3, and 5. Now, minus 1 plus 3 is 2, minus 1 plus 5 is 4, and 3 plus 5 is 8. Aha! We got 3 by using a negative number. We got 3 powers of 2, and that's the best you can do. Obviously, with three numbers, there are only three ways to get sums of two numbers. 3 choose 2 is 3. So that's best possible, and it worked. What about four numbers? Call them A, B, C, and D, such that A plus B is a power of 2, A plus C. There are six sums of pairs. The conjecture is you can't do it, but this is an open question. The best anyone who's looked at this has been able to do is to get four numbers. So if you take minus 3, minus 1, 3, and 5. Let's look at what happens. Minus 3 plus 5 is 2. Minus 1 plus 3 is 2. These can be repeated. The powers of 2 you get can have repetitions. They don't have to be distinct. A minus 1 plus 5 is 4, and 3 plus 5 is 8. So this set of four numbers gives you four powers of 2. As far as anyone knows, that's the best you can do. So I'm going to write down here 4 question mark, because this is still an unsolved question.
Because you could use really whopping big numbers, couldn't you?
It sounds impossible, doesn't it? And it is. Nobody knows how to solve this. Again, you could write a program. Say, let's call them A, B, C, and D. For A from minus infinity to infinity, for B from minus infinity to infinity, make A plus B a power of 2, and so on.
And there are six you could do.
We believe you can't do it, but it's an open, really hard question.
Oh, we love open questions.
Yes. This was a problem of Stan Wagon's. There's a column of problems that's been run from Macalester College in St. Paul, Minnesota, since 1968. It's the problem of the week that's been going on since then. And Stan Wagon took it over in 1993, and he's still running it. This is problem of the week 1321. He will send out a copy of the latest problem to anyone who's interested. This was a problem from earlier this year. Pretty nice problem.
Neil, are you the sort of guy who will see this and spend an afternoon trying to crack it? Or do you just go, oh, that's a nice problem, and move on? Or do you sit down with paper and a pencil and give it some time.
Depends on the problem. Sometimes it'll take over for a week or a month, and then I look up and I say, my God, I've just spent a month working on that problem. And I'm happy to do it. This was not one of them. No, this was obviously impossible. And actually, by the time I saw the problem, he'd sent out the solution. And the way he phrased the problem was, if you've got 10 numbers, how many powers of 2 can you get? So his question was,
I have 10.
He said, I can get 14 to solve the problem. Give me 14 powers of 2. Well, and if possible, do better. So when he sent out the solution, he said various people found 14, and a couple of people found 15. And Rob Pratt proved that 15 is optimal. 15 is optimal for A of 10. And when I was looking at this, I thought, wow, that's incredible. And I wrote to Rob and they said, how on earth did you do that? And he wrote back and said, no, I didn't do it. I assumed the numbers were in a certain range. And with that assumption, I could do the search. Rob's a big expert on linear programming, and this is just his kind of problem. He's an expert on MILP, mixed integer linear programming, and there are an enormous number of problems that he can solve. But he could only solve this. He assumed that the numbers were in some range from A to B. In fact, the range that he picked in the end was, if we're looking for n numbers, let's take them in the range minus n plus 3, n plus 3. So he assumed that each number was in that range. And that range he could search and optimize the number of solutions. And he came up with a sequence, and that sequence is now in the OEIS. But the definition, it's not Stan Wagen's definition, unrestricted numbers. It's restricting them to this range.
Because that's unacceptable to me, Neil. We recently did some videos about expressing numbers as the sum of 3 cubes.
Yes.
And for some numbers to do that, you had to go to incredible lengths. You had to search into sort of 16 or 7 digit numbers.
Yes, that's a famous problem of a similar kind. Yes.
So this, what Rob's done here, just restricting it, like, that just seems like he hasn't solved the problem at all.
No, he doesn't claim to have solved it. And yet, looking back at what he's done, that probably is the solution, or close to it. I'll tell you a bit more about that in a minute.
Did Rob not look at 4 for you, though, to find out what...
He certainly did. And he found this, of course. He couldn't do any better with a much bigger search. Maybe not as big as the sum of 3 cubes search with numbers in the billions.
Okay.
But it's not clear that would really help, actually. I think probably you can't do better with 4 numbers. Let me continue and look at n equals 5. If you can choose 5 numbers, how many powers of 2 can you get? You can get, let me write down the numbers, minus 3, minus 1, 3, 5, and 11. And if I remember correctly, that's going to give us 6 numbers, because we will get minus 3 plus 5 is 2, minus 3 plus 11 is 8. Minus 1 plus 3 is 2, minus 1 plus 5 is 4, minus 1 plus 10, well, 11 is 10, no good. 3 plus 5 is 8, 3 plus 11 is 14, no good. 5 plus 11 is 16. And that gives us 6 numbers. As I said, they don't have to be distinct. This has 2 2s and 2 8s, but that's fine. There are 6 powers of 2 with 5 numbers. And this is the one exception that he didn't, when Rob Pratt wanted to set limits that he could go out to 100. The limits that he worked with were some minus n plus 3 to plus n plus 3, and this is outside his range. For this range, he found minus 4, minus 3, minus 1, 3, 5, which gives 5 numbers, whereas this gives 6 numbers. So we believe that A of 5 is 6. Question mark, and he's gone out to 100. So that's that sequence. Up to n equals 5, we have plausible answers.
Okay.
In fact, we have plausible answers all the way up, really, up to 100. But kind of doubtful. It's quite possible they could be improved once we get above 10 or 12 points. 15 is probably optimal for 10 numbers. And, you know, 10 choose 2 is 45. Instead of 45, we've only gotten 15. So that's not doing very well. Maybe if you were really clever, you could do better. And Stan Wagon and Rob Pratt came up with a lower bound, a lower bound that shows you that you can at least do moderately well in general. Mark Le Brun had an idea. He said, instead of having towers, let's have dungeons. Let's go down. He says, we're going to use the following notation, which actually is in common use. I'll let A sub B mean read A and base B.